Thank you for joining. The event will start momentarily.
Jefferson has my vote. Oh. I never agreed with Jefferson once. Oh. He fought on like 75 different fronts. Oh. But when all is said and all is done, Jefferson has beliefs. Burr has none.
Well, I'll be damned. Well, I'll be damned. Your side.
Well, I'll be damned. Well, I'll be damned.
And you won on a landslide. Congrats on a race well run. I give you a fight. I look forward to our partnership as your vice president.
Yeah, right. You hear this guy? Man openly campaigns against me, talking about I look forward to our partnership.
It is crazy that the guy who comes in second gets to be vice president.
Oh, you know what? We can change that. You know why?
Why? Because I'm the president.
Thank him for the endorsement.
Well, duh.
You just look at you can't. So now it's up to you. Now it's up to you. people come into our lives for a reason, bringing something we must learn, and we are mentors who help us most grow if we let them, and we help them in return. Well, I don't know if I believe that's true, but I know I'm who I am today because I knew you. Like a comet pulled from orbit as it passes the sun, like a stream that meets a boulder halfway through the wood. Who can say if I've changed for the better? Because I knew you. I have been changed for good. It will maybe. Never meet again in this lifetime. So let me see before we part. So much of me is made of what I learned from you. You'll be with me like a handprint on my heart. And now, whatever way our stories end. You have rewritten mine by being my friend. Like a ship blown from its mooring by the wind of the sea. Like a sea dropped by a sky bird in a distant world. Who can say if I've been changed for the better? I knew you, because I knew you. I have been changed for good. And just to clear the air, I ask forgiveness for the things that you laid before. But then I guess we know there's blame to share. And none of it seems to matter anymore. As it rises above the sea stream and meets the sea of the world. Who can say?
Good afternoon, everyone. People are still logging in, so let's give them a moment and then we'll begin in a few seconds.
I do believe I have been changed for the better. Because I knew you. Because I knew you. Because I knew you.
Now a message from Pops Plus Lotion Tissue. Ordinary tissues can leave you with a red nose. So choose Puffs Plus Lotion for all of your blows. Puffs have lotion to soothe sensitive skin so you can wipe without wincing. It's a win-win. Puffs have cushiony thickness, which brings relief too, so the days of sore red noses are gone and through. When you're achieving softness, a nose in need deserves Puffs indeed.
Thank you.
All right, we're just waiting for the presenters to get ready to do their thing, and we'll start momentarily. Hi, Chris.
Hello.
In the old bazaar, let us through. It's a brand new star. Be the first on your
waiting for Rebecca. Do you happen to have her cell phone number?
No, I don't. I'm only here for the initial remarks, and then I have to leave because I've got a girl at home today.
Okay. She's first up. That's why I.
Okay. For some reason, I'm getting music. Nobody else hearing music?
No, there's music playing while we're waiting to start.
It's very strange because that's exactly what my daughter's listening to, so.
It's my favorite music.
Really? She has been obsessively watching Will Smith doing that over and over again.
That's funny.
Yep. And I can tell it's the Will Smith version and not the Robin Williams version.
Yes.
I'm that well versed now in Aladdin.
That's funny. Okay, so some of the instructors are saying they're having trouble logging in, so I'm going to go troubleshoot. So instead of signing in, just put in the meeting ID and password.
Some people long for a life that is simple and
good. I just sent you another email with the
information. With the ribbon, some people won't sell the sea because they're safer on land to follow what's written, but I follow you to the great unknown. Off to a world we call our own. And my heart
try to sign it from another computer. Are you using the app?
We're walking a tightrope, high in the sky, we can see the whole world down below. We're walking a tightrope, never should, never know how far we could fall. But it's all an adventure that comes with a breathtaking view.
Are you in now? Perfect. Yes, I see. Okay, bye.
Mountains and valleys and all that will come in between.
desert and ocean. Do you call me in? And together we're lost in a dream. Always in motion, so I risk it all just to be with you. And I risk it all for this life we choose. And my heart and you promise to never let go. Walk in time.
Sorry, give me just 1 minute. I'm still coordinating, getting people enrolled in the session.
I'm happy I'm not the only one fighting with Zoom.
I guess other people like this too. I'm not the only one. Okay, I'm getting the advisor in, and once I get the advisor in, we can start this show.
Change my background appropriately.
Oh, nice.
Another favorite of my daughter's.
Me and your daughter have the same type of music interest, huh?
She's a smart little girl.
Yeah.
Okay.
Okay, she's in, I think.
I don't know, Zoom didn't, was like, no, you're a student. No, you're actually faculty. You're nothing. Why do, what do
okay,
you want
she's in. All right, perfect. We can start.
Alexander Hamilton. Your name is Alexander Hamilton. Give me. There's a million things I haven't done.
Give me a second.
Wait.
Now I'm having trouble turning off the music. Okay, so sorry about that. All right. As you can see, we should be on a road to getting this show started. So I'm going to welcome everybody and thank everybody for being here. First and foremost, we appreciate everybody's attention, and this is the Biological Sciences Information Session. Today you're gonna learn about the variety of different options for the biology major at Bronx Community College, but I wanna go over some ground rules before I start introducing the speakers. First ground rule, please mute yourself so that you won't interrupt the speakers, okay? You can find the mute in a variety of different areas, whether you're using a tablet, a desktop, or a mobile device. Please make sure you find and locate that mute feature and mute yourself. There will be, at the end of each presentation, about 5 to 10 minutes for questions. We will have questions there. If your question is not answered at the 5 to 10 minute session, you are more than welcome to tap into the chat. The speakers and presenters will be answering questions in the chat. You also have the option of holding your questions to the panel discussion, the Q&A session. So there's a variety of different ways you can get your questions answered. We also have, besides the presenters from the different sub programs in biology, we also have an advisor here who can answer some of your questions. And we also have a financial aid person, an admissions person here to help you for those students that want to get into BCC, into one of these dynamic programs. So that's going to be the order. Please make sure that you're not being rude and you have your mute on. I will try to mute people as they come into the room. But everybody that's existing, please make sure that you mute yourselves. Thank you so much. I'm going to turn it over to, I lost my welcoming. What happened? My welcome went away. Anyway, but my welcome was supposed to be by Chris Robinson, who is the, oh, there it goes. Why did this disappear? What's going on? Okay. So I'm going to pass it over to Dr. Chris Robinson. He is the chair for the Biological Sciences Department. He's going to welcome the students.
Welcome, students. All right, I guess I should say more than that. all right. I am the chairperson currently of the Biological Sciences Department. It is an excellent dynamic department with people doing amazing different types of research, both research in the field of biology, but also research on how to teach more effectively. And if you're ever interested in research that involves fossils, I'm the guy to talk to. So if you love fossils, talk to me. We're going to have presentations today by the coordinators of the five major programs within the biological sciences, starting with Dr. Banks, who you just met briefly on Zoom, who's going to talk about the incredibly growing medical lab technician program. It has doubled in size in the last 5 years, which can be attributed in large part to Dr. Banks's excellent command of this particular program. Our newest program will be next. Dr. Diotti is going to talk about our biotechnology program, which is a new and growing program. Then we go to the program I used to run, but is now run by Professor Araya, the Animal Care and Management Program, that focuses on taking care of animals, specifically domesticated animals, and has an internship in a veterinarian's office. So if you love animals, talk to Professor Araya. Then we'll get to Dr. Melidi, who's going to talk all about the actual bio major at BCC, if you are interested in just being a typical bio major. And then lastly, Dr. Adebola will be talking about the horticulture program and the work that you're able to do at the New York Botanical Gardens and elsewhere around the city. If you are interested in plants and horticulture, Dr. Adebola is the one to talk to. So without further ado, I will give it back to Dr. Banks to talk about the MLT program. I have to jump off the call because I have a 4-year-old who demands my attention. So nice to meet all of you. I'm going to put my email in the chat. If you want to get a hold of me, you can email me at the address that is now in the chat about anything to do with this department. So enjoy the speakers. They are all excellent. I highly recommend all of these programs. I don't play favorites. So take it away, Dr. Banks.
Thank you, Dr. Robinson. He's a great chair for the Biological Sciences Department, so very resourceful. So please make sure you utilize that email that he put in the chat. I'm going to move on to the Medical Laboratory Technician Program presentation. So those of you that's here for MLT, thank you and welcome. And so we're going to stop sharing here. And we're going to relocate to start sharing here. Okay, did it work? Yes. Okay, so what we're gonna talk about is the medical laboratory technician program. It's part of the medical laboratory sciences, which is an entire big branch under pathology, which is the study of pathogens in tissues, cells, and body fluids. So what I wanna talk about is my presentation is going to encompass science, medicine, and biotechnology, because we intersect all of the above. Okay, so I am Dr. Diane Price Banks. I am the MLT program director, and I am so happy to be here and presenting this program to you today. Okay, so what do medical laboratorians do? And that's always one of the first questions, right? What do? Well, we analyze blood, body fluids, tissues, and cells to determine the presence or absence of abnormal cells, and specifically diseases, right? Our job is to help the doctors and nurses diagnose patients, okay? 70% of the diagnoses people receive from the hospital are provided by the laboratory. That's us. 30% is provided by doctors simply saying, you have a stomach ache, then you must have a stomach virus. That's guessing. And 30% of those are guessing based on their scientific background, their knowledge of what the signs and symptoms look like, okay? But definitely use a scientific approach would be to send a sample to the lab and have the lab analyze it to confirm the doctor's diagnosis. So we are highly skilled and we use the latest biomedical techniques and instruments to help diagnose these patients. So we diagnose cancer, diabetes, kidney disease, drug overdoses, et cetera. So here's the great thing about our field, right? You have the option to specialize or become a generalist. When you graduate from BCC as an MLT major, you're going to be a generalist. Specialists come after where you seek employment in a specialized field. So we're gonna talk a little bit about that. So a specialist is someone who specializes in one key area of the lab, okay? Generalist is someone who can work in a core lab, and a core lab is someone who has expertise that intersects all the other labs, chemistry, microbiology, hematology, cytology, et cetera, versus someone that just only works in microbiology, okay? So for example, I was a generalist when I first started, and then I specialized in microbiology for 10 years, right? So I worked 14 years in a lab. Of the 14 years, 10 of those years were specializing in microbiology. I did happen to work in the other labs as well. And the benefit of that is when... Thank you for noticing that.
No problem.
Go ahead, co-host. All right. Yes, this session is being recorded. So let's talk about some of these areas that you can work in the laboratory. So we have clinical chemistry. Clinical chemistry tech, they will analyze body fluids for many diverse proteins, sugars, enzymes, lipids, hormones, drugs, etc. For example, when someone has a drug overdose, chemistry is doing that. They're running toxicology. If the court says, we want to see if this person is smoking marijuana, give the lab a urine sample. We're testing to see if that person has marijuana, barbiturates, cocaine in their system. Hormones, we're checking hormones for pregnant women, for example, to make sure that the pregnancy is going well. We're also checking lipids, that cholesterol, triglycerides. We're looking to see if the person has hypertension, for example. So we're doing a lot of things in the chemistry department, right? We're also diagnosing diabetes, okay? But we don't just work with the fluids, we also collaborate with the other departments like microbiology, histology, coagulation, et cetera. So these are, just because you're specializing in one area, understand that you're gonna be working in a variety of different areas or with different areas as well. Another key area is microbiology. Again, this is usually a specialized area. I happen to be a generalist who worked in microbiology, then became a specialist in microbiology, and that's how that happened. But basically what we're doing is we're detecting and identifying disease-causing bacteria and parasites. So we're looking for diseases like sexually transmitted infections, like gonorrhea, chlamydia, syphilis, et cetera. And we're diagnosing the patient, giving that report to the doctor and the nurses, and the PAs, of course, and they in turn is telling that to the patients what their diagnosis were from the laboratory. This is one of my favorite departments. So if you want, so if you come to one of my microbiology classes, you will know, you will have fun. This is a picture of a man plating. He's taking the sample, the urine sample, and he's plating it on a blood agar plate. He's gonna incubate that plate for 18 to 24 hours. When he comes back the next day, he's gonna read that plate. There's gonna be microorganisms on that plate. And he's gonna be able to decipher if those organisms are normal and they're supposed to be there versus abnormal and they're pathogenic. Okay, moving on to, she said, I'm sorry, I'm not seeing the presentation. Rafi, can you troubleshoot with that young lady who's not seeing the presentation? I see it on my screen. So I think that she has to open up her dialogue box. Okay, histology is a study of blood cells, specifically white blood cells, red blood cells, and platelets. And what we're looking for is like leukemias, infections, sickle cells, et cetera. So what we're doing is we're using these large instruments and we're running the samples through these large instruments to give us pictures at the bottom of red blood cells, white blood cells in the middle, and sickled cells at the end. And we're giving that diagnosis to the patient, to the doctors. Coagulation. How many, raise your hand, your virtual hand, if you know anybody or if you ever heard of the word hemophiliac. Raise your virtual hand, hemophiliac. No one, what? Interesting, one person, okay. So coagulation basically is where we're going to look to see how quickly the blood is clotting, okay? And we want to see that to make sure that the person is not going to continue to bleed or hemorrhage is the other word. So we're using a lot of instruments to test that. We're also testing therapy, anticoagulant therapy like heparin, Coumadin, warfarin. We're looking to see if they're clotting the blood in a certain amount of time. Blood should ideally coagulate between 30 and 60 seconds. So if that's not happening, then the doctors have to create some type of treatment that would make sure that the person is clotting responsibly. Blood bank and hematology, these are studies of the red blood cells specifically. They also study platelets and plasma. This is where you're going to be transfusing blood to a patient. This lab is very crucial and it's usually a specialist doing it, because we can potentially kill a patient if we give them the wrong blood components. So it's all about compatibility. Can I give this person blood that's compatible with their existing blood? And if we happen to give them blood that's not, that person will be sent to immunologic response and could potentially cause them death. So we need to make sure that everybody that's working in blood bank know blood bank, okay? And just off of a Black History Month, I did a segment on Dr. Charles Drew. He was an African-American doctor who worked in blood bank and really specialized and developed the procedures that we use today in the clinical laboratory for blood banking. So it was amazing that he did that. He was one of the people who was receiving blood and sending blood out to the soldiers in a war so that the blood can be transfused for those that were had injuries, sustained major injuries. Only thing, because he was African-American, he could not donate his own blood and he could not get his community to donate blood because they were African-Americans in it. And at that time, it was not acceptable. So he did an amazing job and we're still using those techniques today. Immunology specifically worries about the antibodies and the antigens. And that's where the COVID-19 testing comes in. So I know everybody knows about COVID-19. They know about the testing. Everybody's pushing everybody to get tested, but the people testing in the lab is us. So we have graduates right now and students on internship who is actually running the COVID-19 test in New York City. So kudos and shout out to them. They're also running the antibody test. So remember, with you have antibodies and antigens, when you go to a testing center, they more than likely are testing the antigen. The antigen indicates that you are actively infectious. The antibody indicates that you may have immunity to the previous infection. So it's pretty cool, and that's immunology. The new wave right now, we're moving toward molecular diagnostics. This is where we're merging with biotechnology. We're taking instrumentation and we're looking at the DNA and the RNA and proteins of the genetic makeup of these viruses and pathogens, et cetera. And we're using that to determine their existence, their presence, and their identification, which is the diagnosis. And lastly, we have histology and cytology. This is a crucial role in diagnosing using tissues and cells. We take tissues and cells, cut them up, and make them into slides. And my slide did not even show up here, but that's cool. And you see the lab tech creating the slide here. And then the next lab tech is getting ready to stain it. So this is basically looking for cancers. And if somebody had an amputation, looking to see why their leg had to be amputated, whether the area that was amputated was free of microorganisms or not. So this is a very crucial area. Most of our students, when they graduate, they start working in the cytology histology lab first. Okay, so why is this important? Well, this is important because I mentioned before that 70% of the diagnosis come from the lab. If you look at our picture here, you see the patient and the families in the middle, and then you see medical lab in that consortium is part of that. Because again, we're helping to provide those diagnoses to the doctor, nurses, and physicians. So do we just work in hospital labs? No, you could work in a hospital lab, a physician's office lab, commercial labs. For example, how many of you on your block or going to your medical facility have seen a little small box that says bioreference or core lab? Raise your virtual hand if you've seen core lab or bioreference box outside of your medical office. Okay, perfect, perfect. I see some people know about it. All right. So that's the large commercial reference labs. And basically we have usually have a courier who goes and pick those specimens up, take those to the large voluminous labs, and we run those tests there. Or you could work in public health labs. So there's many opportunities that you can work in. But we also ask our students, once you graduate from the MLT program at BCC, we want you to advance your career. There's a few places you can advance your career for the bachelor's degree level. And that's Hunter, York, College of Staten Island, Stony Brook, St. John's University, and Mercy College. I put them in order of least expensive to most expensive, okay? So these are the varieties that are available to those that want to advance their career. Now, why do I say advance your career? Well, when you graduate from BCC, you'll make about $50,000 to $52,000 a year, right? If you advance and go to the bachelor's degree that jumps to $70,000 to $80,000 a year. And if you go on to get the master's degree in the field, that's about $90,000 to $105,000 that you can be making at the master's degree level. So we definitely want you guys to advance if you're interested in MLT. You can advance into medicine, dentistry, public health, biomedical technology, et cetera. So as I mentioned before, there's multiple employment opportunities. You can specialize, you can generalize, you can advance, become a lab supervisor, a lab director, become a pathology assistant. It's endless. The flexibility is there's three typical work shifts, daytime 8 to 4, evening 4 to midnight, and overnight midnight to 8. So there's a lot of flexibility there, okay? Just some highlights. We're the third largest group of health professionals. So we go doctors, nurses, and then medical lab science. Okay. Over 7 billion clinical lab tests are performed each year. And that's more in light of COVID. All right. We have about 171,000 labs across the United States. So why is this beneficial to you? Those that come to BCC and graduate from BCC MLT program sit and take the ASCP exam, which is the American Society for Clinical Pathology exam, and pass it, which we have an 86% pass rate on the first shot. What is that going to do for you? You are now able to work anywhere in the United States and its territories as a medical laboratory science student. Pretty cool, right? I thought so too. Just want to let you know what the salary looks like, because that's always important. At the bottom, in the tri-state area, New York, New Jersey area, the annual salary is about $52,530. And that's just annual. Now, if you go to Rhode Island, you're going to be making a little more. So just want to point that out. So at the BCC program, in order to get into our program, you first have to finish those top courses, the English 10 or 11, chemistry 17, math 13 or 30, and bio 11 or bio 23, which is anatomy and physiology. If you come from another college, like you have a bachelor's degree or you have transfer credits, and you come in with these existing courses, we will accept those. MLT accepts up to 33 of your existing credits that correspond with our program, okay? You will spend 3 didactic semesters with the MLT program, first, second, and third, as the, on the list in that order, okay? And then you will go on your clinical internship. A clinical internship is 500 hours, is 15 weeks, Monday through Friday, and here's the kicker, it's a paid internship. Right now, yes, we're paying students $17 an hour to do their internship. So this is remarkable. This is a milestone that we've been able to achieve. So some of the students that was having financial difficulties, say no more, we got you covered. All right, so I'll be in the chat if you have any questions, comments, or concerns. I will be organizing this event as well. So stay tuned for the panel. We'll have a more robust dialogue.
Just a little question, because I'm still trying to solve the issue. And she's on an iPhone, and so switching mode. So for the presentation, because I don't know if other people are having the same issues, and I'm trying to figure out how to, for them to find on the iPhone, the button to actually switch mode so they don't just see our faces, but the presentation. I don't have an iPhone, so I'm like, oh, how is this done?
I will work with her.
Try to turn the phone this way. Horizontal, maybe that'll help.
Well, I think she's like, and you can do it on the desktop. She can see the face, but not the presentation. And there should be a view thing that allows her to do it, but she says she doesn't see it. So I'm like, oh.
Okay, well, I can work with her on the sidelines.
Okay.
All right. So
this is Rebecca. Can I interject? Can you make me a co-host?
Oh, yeah, sure.
Thanks a lot.
I don't have the superpower either.
I'll do it, not a problem.
Thanks.
Got no powers whatsoever, actually.
All right, everybody. So we just finished the medical laboratory technician program presentation. We now will move on to biotechnology. So I will introduce Dr. Rafaela Diotti. She is the biotechnology the coordinator for it. And she's the person to contact if you're interested in biotechnology. So Dr. Diotti, you may take it away.
Yes, and now I have to figure out how to take it away. Sorry, it's gonna happen. As I think we've already figured out on biotechnology, but obviously there's some issues with the technology here. But that's okay, the bio part is good. So, okay, I can share like that. I'm good with it. So, biotech program, as Dr. Robinson was saying, we are one of the kind of like the newbies for the programs, but we are working our way up, okay? And it's actually very apropos that we came after MLT because, as Dr. Banks was saying, there is a lot of like crossover, and you're actually going to see these also with some of the other topics with biotechnology, because that's how awesome we are. So if you want to be a biotechnologist, you should totally get into our program because we're gonna make you see the world. No, I'm just joking. Well, actually no, you can potentially also see the world. So what is biotechnology, first of all? This is the official definition. is an applied science that uses living organisms, their part and their cellular and molecular processes and products to develop technologies and goods to improve lives and solve different kinds of problems, which is like, what? So the important thing that you want to know here is that it's applied. So there is a lot of the theories, but the idea of biotechnology is that you want to create and you want to apply whatever is actually what you are learning in the course. And obviously we want to save lives and do all the other cool things that, you know, you can also become evil, but we don't support that, okay? So if you want to be a bioterrorist, don't take my courses, okay? Don't take this program. I'm just saying, oh, it's recorded. Well, I officially told you. So, so if you're really interested in these magic things, right? When people ask you, what do you want to do when you grow up? Oh, I want to cure cancer. I want to save lives like in whatever country. Oh, hunger is a problem because we have like overpopulation. Guess all of these things. Oh, you're really interested in the environment. You're interested in biodiversity. You're interested in finding like a green energy. Well, all of these things can be things that you can do if you get a biotechnology degree. So let's get actually into a little more of the nitty gritty. What the heck does that actually mean in terms of doing it? Well, biopharmacology, okay? Biopharma. We've seen it with COVID, all those like tests to actually test COVID, the one that then Dr. Banks and her students were using to test all this kind of stuff. All the research and the development was done by biotechnologists, by people in the biopharma industry. Developing new drugs. People are going bonkers now a little about the monoclonal antibodies that can be used for COVID and that that then being used for like some people. They're probably going to get into the market. This is actually research that comes from biotechnology. Again, it's an applied. Obviously, there is a theoretical basis, but then you have to think about the application. If you are like, biopharma, they're evil, whatever the heck you think about that, you can get into industrial biotech, okay? We are very worried about the environment, about pollution and so on, about sustainable energy. Again, biotech can help with that. There are actually some places, if you think about biofuels, not just the corn, but also other kind of fuels, create new material that are actually more environmentally friendly. That's biotech. You are like, I don't care about all this synthetic stuff, and you are like me, and you love food. Well, guess what? Part of the soft material sciences is actually making yogurt and making cheese and making wine and beer. Think if you're a vegan, the impossible burgers. That's actually where the idea came of actually using material that is still organic material that can mimic meat and then can be grown in the lab. I mean, I'm sorry, I don't know if I'm gonna go to that place, but if that's the place where you want to be, or eventually, right? Think about maybe making food. We saw Perseverance like landing on Mars, like food that can actually be used if we have long-term missions like in space. That's the kind of, you know, applied science that if you are into food production, you may care for. Environmental application. Again, biodiversity is super important. We keep on saying that we are in the middle of the sixth, like mass destruction. And we want to know more about what's out there and how we can preserve it, okay? It's not just removal of pollutants, it's also how can we look at organisms and what the effect of changes on the environment are on the organism at the level of the DNA, so we can look at like, you know, changes. If that's what you're interested in, biotechnology can help with that. When we talk about food and feeding the hungry in the world, we think about agriculture. So humans have been selecting out plants and animals that they want anyway for a long time. Now we can do it actually looking at the genes in the lab and then inserting them into plants. One of the things that we've done as we were selecting out stuff is that we actually decreased the variability of what we have out there. So now the idea is, can we create something that can produce and can keep on living? Because remember, climate is changing with the climate change and support the population. And then there are a lot of places that we have not explored, but we think that are gonna be the source of a lot of important discoveries, like marine resources. There's a lot of biodiversity, potentially a lot of compounds that can be used for drugs, for diseases in the future. hopefully we are a little smarter now than we were when we used to go and plow everything and destroy everything. So we're going to look at marine resources using all the information that we are garnering from an understanding of biodiversity and so on. So we can use those resources without destroying the environment that they come from. And again, all that information, that ability to apply the information that we're learning to this kind of discoveries come from biotechnology. Okay. So again, we're still looking at the big pictures. We went from like, hey, feeding the hungry to maybe we can do that by genetically altering or like learning more about the genetics of some of the plants. But what kind of jobs can you actually get with biotechnology? One of the things that I haven't actually mentioned that is important, I'm all talking about doing stuff in the lab, is actually bioinformatics. That's becoming one of the big fields because we have been collecting a lot of data, and now we have the capacity with computer to look at the data collected and try to extract information. So part of biotechnology is also getting some of the knowledge from bioinformatics, and that's going to be probably one of the big fields. Well, it's already one of the big fields that, like, you know, that is coming up in terms of like careers, like, you know, being able to handle big chunks of data. You can be a clinical research associate. Dr. Banks was just talking about the fact that a lot of the applied science actually goes into clinical testing and clinical labs. If you are interested in being part of the next version of CSI, you can be a forensic DNA analyst. There are also some other applications that goes into the forensic science. You can also, again, if you want to be a generalist and just learn stuff and then decide what you want to specialize, you can be a laboratory assistant, a research associate. You can go into academic research. So you can be the person that is actually looking at this information before it it's going to be applied. And again, a lot of academic labs are actually getting patents for some of the discovery that they make to do that transition from the academia, from the basic research to the applied part of the research. You can also think about in other ways. Maybe you like more the automated part of the application. So maybe you do like the computers. You don't want to be into bioinformatics, but in a lot of the labs, when you are applying these techniques, you don't just want to have the person pipetting like crazy. You may want to think more in an engineering, from an engineering point of view, being able to understand the science behind it and maybe create robots or things like that, that can run the experiment in a way that is consistent. Again, that becomes actually important, not that much maybe for running the test where humans are still doing it, but if you want to produce a lot of the vaccine or something like that. So you can think about the engineering part. Something that again is super important and you need to understand the science is quality assurance. Okay, again, you cannot be producing a drug, you cannot be producing those monoclonal antibody or that vaccine or those tests if you don't know that you're putting something on the market that is actually doing what it's supposed to do. We did have a little snafu at the beginning of COVID where some of the testing that were produced were actually not as good as they were supposed to be. And yes, it was an emergency, but this is, you can be the person that is like, okay, no, you have to go back to the drawing board. There's something that this is not as good as it is supposed to be, okay? And then if you're like, well, I've done all this science and blerg, I don't want to work in a lab. I don't want to do all these things, but I think they're awesome and I can sell these products. If you are more of a business marketing person, you can be a sales representative or you can be someone, and again, they actually make a lot of money because I have a friend that transferred to the kind of job. You can be one of the technical service representative. You either get the phone calls when something is not working and you can help out the person, or you can be the person that goes to the labs and train people in the machinery that they're using, train people in the assays that they're using, okay? So you have really a wide variety of things that you can do with these degrees that cater to what you think are your strengths. And it allows you with some flexibility if you're moving along your career and you're learning more about yourself. Let's talk dinero though, because at the end of the day, you know, you put in all this effort, you want something back. So with an associate, you can get on average, okay, in the country from 40 to 50K. And again, because of the way that the business is moving, there are more possibility to actually get a job as an associate in different labs. If you decide to take the next step, obviously, as Dr. Bank was saying, the higher you go, the hopefully more money you can make because you're acquiring more more knowledge. So if you get to the bachelor level, on average, you can make around like 60, 70,000 K. If you decide to go for your master, you can make 80 or 90K, okay? What's really important in this field, and obviously if you go for a PhD, well, it depends what kind of job you really get, but you can make more money. What really makes a difference is experience, okay? In a lot of the companies, not all of them, but sometimes you can start with an associate and they either will pay you maybe to go ahead with your like studies, but you can find people that maybe have something of a lower degree, but they've been there for 10 or 15 years. Their experience is so wide that their salary also goes with that. It is becoming a little more competitive. That was a little more old school. Right now, the piece of paper also does make the difference, also because things are moving relatively, relatively fast. And obviously, as always in the private sector, you are making a little more money than in academia. But again, in a lot of places in academia, you have these translational programs where you are going from the basic science to the applied science, okay? What you can get from us, again, we are starting out and we are very dynamic and we really want to do stuff, but you are going to get like a small class sizes, which means that you're going to get a little more attention. You're going to have the chance to work in teams and independently in the lab or, you know, for this year on the computer. But again, we started working on some bioinformatics projects and so on. And again, this is the kind of program like with MLT that you can take what you're learning in the lecture and apply it in the lab. Now, just to give you an example of what potential you're going to be applying. This protein, and this is what biotechnology is, and I'm just going to give you like an example. We have fluorescent proteins that come from creatures, like for example, this jellyfish, okay? Now, we were able, and by we, I mean, not me, but I used it, to take the protein from the jellyfish and we can actually put it into other organisms, like for example, a bacteria, okay? And then we can grow the bacteria and the bacteria is growing. And you're like, well, that's great. Why are you doing that? We actually can take the protein and attach it to proteins that we want to learn about. For example, we want to learn about their location in the cell. It's a cancer protein. We know that that protein is important for cancer. Where is it going? Okay, in the cell. Where is it? What is its location? Well, I'm going to attach another fluorescent protein that comes from the jellyfish, and I can follow where the protein actually goes in the cell. So for you, one of the experiments that you do in the lab, you do this part, okay, where you're taking the protein, you're putting in the bacteria, and you have it expressed in the bacteria, which seems like very easy, but it is a lot of different technique that you have to use to do it. Now, just to show you how things can go in direction that you don't think about. So people use this for like a good, like a, I think it was discovered in the 70s, really applied in the 80s, and now we're using it normally in the lab. Obviously, they're thinking about how can we use it in the lab? And then someone is like, oh, I have an idea. Let's put it in animals and make fluorescent animals that we can sell on the market. So these kind of animals are a little expensive, but you definitely can get for a decent price some of the fluorescent beta fish that are out there. So you can have your own fluorescent animals. And again, it's applied, is not the way that I would have necessarily sent it. But at the same time, again, you make these discoveries that are basic science and then you can apply them in strange ways. And by the way, this is the little mice down here are a little more the scientific part where you take actually a mouse and you want to see if the protein is expressed in the babies. And you can see some of the babies here are not expressing the protein and these babies are expressing the protein. And then I don't know why you'd want a red and a green cat. But again, if you can have the money, you can, and you can afford it, by all means, I ain't stopping you. But again, some of the basic science is actually then applied in ways that you don't even think about. And that could be a market. Maybe you're a marketing person. You're like, I don't want to cure cancer. I want to make fluorescent cats. You can do that. You can start, you can have your own startup. All right, let's talk about what's going on in terms of the courses. Obviously, it's a community college. We want to get you in and out in 2 years, okay? And a lot, well, this looks terrible. All right, I'm gonna give you an interpretation of the courses. So a lot of the courses are some of the basic courses, by the way, that you can need if you are not sure if you want to be going to medicine, for example, or if you're not sure about what you want to do after this. You can't really see them, but what's going on here is that you're going to do introduction to bio, you're going to do the intro to chemistry, you're going to do your calculus. A lot of the courses that are actually the basic courses for other fields, if that's what you decide to do. But what they're going to give you, like the important courses that you're going to do for biotechnology, is actually the genetics and the cell biology. Because again, the idea of biotechnology is that you're taking bits and pieces of other organisms and you are applying that knowledge to something else. You can, for example, take again the gene from the jellyfish and put it in other organisms. Okay? So this is the, and again, I'm sorry, you can send me an email or you can actually go on BCC webpage and you can get the course and you can see it a little better. I didn't realize it was gonna look so terrible. But again, we want you in and out in the 2 years. And if you follow the course, and that reminds me that if you have any questions or if you want to set up your courses, you can come to me. And then we can talk about how to go through the different courses and what you should register for and so on. And then I'm gonna send you to our awesome counselor that are here and advisors, because you all can be part of different programs and I can't help you with that, but they know. So they are in contact with us. Every time you come to us, we tell you what you should do based on your degree. And then we send you to them and they give you all the other information that is necessary for you know, financial aid and so on and so forth. I probably told too much than I was supposed to. I have the feeling. So what I'm doing now is I'm just gonna thank you. I am gonna put my email also on the side and that's it. I got nothing else unless you got questions. And I even know how to stop sharing. Ta-da! Yes, no, maybe so. No questions? I can live with that. I wasn't that contagious, Diane. You don't need to put on your mask just because I'm talking biotechnology. I'm not spreading viruses.
Oh, Ralph, you didn't mention that your name has a lot of double letters there. So maybe.
Yeah. Yes. If you are in doubt when you are sending me an email, just add an extra letter.
All right, so I'm going to do product placement now. Here's my mask. I was on mute. That's why nobody heard me. I apologize. We're going to move this presentation on and along. So thank you, Dr. DLT, for explaining the biotechnology program to us. We're now going to move on to animal care, who is the course coordinator for animal care management is Professor Rebecca Araya. So I'm going to set her up and spotlight her so you guys can learn about animal care management. And those of you that's on campus and you want to get a mask from campus at the Student Service Center, you can get one of these beautiful blacked out masks with the mascot and the
wow. Bronco. For free?
For free.
Wow.
That's the part that surprised me. Please always remember to double mask. That's an awesome mask, but it's still yes. Not like going to be very protective.
That's right. Two masks.
I just have to say that.
Two masks, everybody. Okay, thank you, Dr. Price-Banks, and thank you, Dr. Diotti. You're tough acts to follow. My name is Rebecca Araya, and I'm the program coordinator for the Animal Care and Management Certificate, and it's my honor to talk to you about the program. So I'm gonna queue up the PowerPoint. Let's see, what can I do here? I guess I multiple, okay, my screen, there we are. All right, now we're cooking with gas. All right, so let me make this a, so that everybody can see this okay. All right, without seeing me. Okay, current slide. All right, can everyone see this okay? I hope.
Yes.
All right,
yes.
Awesome. So just a little history. We've had this program at BCC for at least 20 years. And when Dr. Adebola talks to you about the horticulture program, she will also say the same thing. So we are basically kind of providing a service that not a lot of people have known about. And that is, number one, a kind of a stepping off point into the world of veterinary medicine. Now, just to kind of give this sort of context here, our program, which is called Animal Care and Management, is more of a veterinary assistant program. So you that are interested in working with animals probably all know about veterinarians. Veterinarians are essentially medical doctors of non-human animals, and they tend to specialize. Then below that level, there are veterinary technicians who are certified and can basically assist veterinarians. And so when I talk about certification, I'm talking about things such as Dr. Price Banks was talking about, things like drawing blood or, you know, doing basically assistance with surgeries and other medical procedures. And then below that level are veterinary assistants. Okay, so in New York State, a veterinary assistant does not have to be certified, but they are not certified to do things like invasive procedures. So what do I mean by invasive? I'm talking about things like drawing blood or actually kind of doing things like dental cleaning. But regardless, you learn to basically work with a veterinary technician as well as a veterinarian and basically get hands-on experience in a veterinary setting. Okay, so let me just advance here. So hopefully you can see this, it's not all blocked out, but the purpose of the program, like I've mentioned in brief, is to provide basically a career path, primarily with domesticated animals, although sometimes you may work in a setting where wild animals or feral animals are introduced. Also, we have the honor of having partnerships with local veterinary clinics as well as animal hospitals. And I just want to put this into context of COVID-19, because essentially that's really kind of changed a lot of things, both for the good and the bad. But we've had the luck of working with the Animal Medical Center of New York, which those of you who have pets may be aware of, that's located on the middle of New York City on the East River. And they are a 24-hour facility. Unfortunately, with COVID-19, they had to temporarily suspend their voluntary or internship programs because of, you know, insurance liability issues and all that. But as we see the light at the end of the tunnel with, thanks biotechnology, vaccines, we can now kind of resume our relationship with them. So we've worked with everybody from small veterinarians, like, you know, storefront veterinarians, to large 24-hour facilities such as the Animal Medical Center of New York. Also, our whole idea is to prepare and introduce students to, like I mentioned before, the veterinary field, and especially how veterinary kind of facilities are run. So you can already imagine that going and taking, let's say, your pet to a storefront, you know, mom and pop vet is a different kind of experience than taking, let's say, your very sick animal to a 24-hour facility in the middle of the night, right? So our program kind of offers that kind of, like, we can match, let's say, what you're willing to work with to a particular facility. Continuing on, we provide a foundation. And so it's not just basically kind of introduction to our internship, you know, volunteer kind of workplace in the veterinary setting, but also the opportunity to continue your education if you do want to become a veterinary technician or a veterinarian. So you can sort of move to these different kinds of job descriptions. So with that, we are fully articulated with Mercy College in Dobbs Ferry that has a veterinary technology program. And latest news, because we're all evolving here, is that BCC is currently interested in developing its own veterinary technology program. That's something that's going down the road. But right now, our certificate program is focused on veterinary assistants. Okay, so much like my colleagues who preceded me talked about, an average veterinary salary, and as you all know, minimum wage hopefully will be now set at $15 an hour across the board, but usually it's about $42,000. Which is usually 7% higher or so than the kind of average USA average for a veterinary assistant. Okay, so like I'd mentioned before, we offer a variety, or at least pre-COVID, we offered a complete variety of vets. Right now we're working with smaller vets. That will change once vaccines are in place and there's a light at the end of the tunnel. But basically a veterinary practice is a lot like this one. This is one very dear to my heart one, because they've taken on a lot of our students, and some of you may be familiar with it. It's located near the Kingsbridge Armory, and they are a small storefront vet, but they have a large clientele. They are busy. So sometimes small vets can be very busy vets. So what I'm going to do in the next slides is show you what kind of things are expected in such a practice, and basically what kind of procedures are done, what type of cases are seen, and so on, especially for those that are interested in the animal practice. So although I mentioned that there seems to be a hierarchy between vet assistant, vet technician, and veterinarian, many times in small practices, the jobs and responsibilities can overlap to a certain extent. And because it is small, there is a lot more intimacy with regard to learning about hands-on stuff, right? So it's very, I guess, more adaptable in terms of learning stuff on the fly, and this cat would agree right now. So I provided kind of a pie chart showing the kinds of roles that you would expect in a veterinary setting or in a general setting, including a hospital. So you would have a manager, a medical director, the owner, who may or may not be present there. By the way, also something that I learned is sometimes a lot of these small storefront vets are actually owned by a corporation. So sometimes they, like corporations do, get restructured. You will have your front desk team. I call the front desk team the frontline workers, basically the ones that are there to welcome the pet owners and their pets. And many times it's these people that also have to establish a calm and stress-free environment. So even though you would be working with non-human animals, really you're going to be working with human animals too, because essentially, that's the business. You know, they're going to bring in their pets to be checked up, but many times they're going to bring in their pets who are very sick and need to be taken care of, or, you know, for a variety of reasons. So there are licensed vet techs, also vet assistant, like I mentioned before, not certified, not licensed, but basically there to work on the job and learn and see, kind of feel, get their feelers for what they'd like to do post-job, which I'll talk about a little bit more. Some vets offer kennel services like overnight stays or, you know, extended stays for pets, and then grooming. Sometimes that's done in certain practices, not at all practices. And some pet owners might know that sometimes grooming you can do at, you know, stores like Petco or something like that. So let's move on. So general practice and flow in a vet, like, you know, the office I talked about at the Kingsbridge Armory, are, you know, fielding phone calls, checking in patients, attending, you know, your patients or the pet owners during a visit, checking them out, following up with them. Other factors, like I mentioned before, really important, creating a stress-free, stress and fear fear-free environment, really important, especially, you know, because there's going to be a lot of sick animals, a lot of people who are worried or concerned about the condition of their animals. Also, very importantly, cats and dogs many times may not get along, just like cats and cats and dogs. So, you know, making sure that they're separate so there's no fights that break out amongst any animals in the waiting room. And then also dealing with, very importantly, infectious disease protocols, such as keeping strict hygiene and all that stuff that makes us at least stave off disease, sickness, and endemics, like what we are experiencing now, post-pandemic. Okay, so also things that are really important in a vet's office are, you know, scheduling wellness and sick pet exams, vaccines, you know, heartworm and tests for parasites, other parasites, doing elective procedures. These would all be things that if not, you're not going to be performing them. The vet tech and the vet would be performing them, but you could be assisting with. Also very important in the veterinary setting is, you know, giving out basically things like prescription foods, which is a big thing in the pet industry, and also boarding of pets is if that's what the particular vet that you'll work for does. Okay, so general types of cases, I won't read the exhaustive list here, but there are a variety of cases. Now, these things can be performed at a small vet and more at a larger vet, such as, you know, a hospital vet, like I mentioned before. So this kind of brings us to the Animal Medical Center. And the Animal Medical Center, like I mentioned, is a 24-hour, 7-day-a-week vet. And they can see a diversity of things. And they even do things like cancer research and cancer treatments. So they will do basically all the kinds of treatments that humans can receive in a hospital setting, especially in a teaching hospital setting. They'll do the same thing for non-human animals. And what's more, you'll see the picture down here. This fellow here is holding a monitor lizard, basically an exotic animal. So sometimes they will actually treat animals from places that where they were rescued or taken from by the ASPCA. Right, so that's a really exciting dynamic place. So once again, more kinds of things that can be done in a veterinary setting, which are pretty exciting. Like I said, cancer cases, all the way down to orthopedic injuries and, you know, toxicity and, you know, foreign body things, right? So just like humans would be, you know, taken care of, so would you see these sort of diverse procedures done for non-human animals. Okay, so veterinary assistants, what would they do in these small or larger settings? You can learn how to restrain an animal, and that's actually basically an art, a skill that's learned. Like you may have a pet and you may know how to hold your pet, maybe not. You would learn the proper way to restrain an animal without causing harm to the animal or to yourself. Also, starting appointments, customer service, assisting with surgery prep, which is really important, cleaning cages, you know, making sure that the environment is hygienic and safe and there's no cause for contagion being spread. Also, restocking and inventory, like I said, things like prescription foods and medicines are a really important part of animal care as well. And then cleaning and packing of surgical instruments. So it can be a very dynamic environment, especially with learning all the ins and outs of veterinary care. Okay, other opportunities. I had mentioned before that we do offer we have basically an articulation with Mercy College, and we are trying to diversify and establish other things, which I'll talk about lastly. But you can learn about inventory, different specialties like prescription foods, improve your restraint technique. And so, as you know, in veterinary settings, it's usually cats or dogs, but you may work for a vet who works with reptiles or exotic birds and so on. Client communication education, which is always a good skill, no matter what it is in life that you do. Safety and compliance, which is always important in many different fields, as well as also the possibility to progress on from veterinary assistant to licensed vet tech. And then, you know, the world's your oyster, moving on from there. And then another really important thing is supervisory roles. I mentioned that even small vets nowadays may actually be owned by umbrella companies. And so in these umbrella companies, they may need kind of like regional managers to visit and oversee a collection of veterinary offices. So it really is kind of a way to diversify into different fields, even if, let's say, hands-on work with animals may not be your thing. And I mention this because I've actually had students in the past who've told me, I'm going to tell you a secret, I don't really care for, you know, keeping or taking care of cats and dogs, but I'm interested in assisted therapy. I'm interested in actually how introducing, you know, tame cats and dogs can help people heal after, let's say, something like post-traumatic stress disorder. So really, the world is your oyster with regard to the diversity of things that you can do. Okay, so this basically is the rundown, which is also on the BCC website for the Animal Care and Management Program, of all the courses that are involved in this program, with the credits highlighted here. It is a 30-credit program, which is why it's called a certificate program. It's not an associate's. So one more thing I have to add is that if you are interested in this certificate program, I have had students in the past actually do the certificate and then actually transfer credits into an associate's at BCC. So for instance, I've had students do their certificate and then, you know, become a biology major or a chemistry major. You cannot double major at, you know, a two-year college, but you could actually transfer your credits from one thing into the other. Okay, and then the next last thing that I'm going to say is that the animal care and management internship is the last thing that you would do in the certificate program. It is currently 500 hours of working for a vet that you are placed with, and I would be doing the placement. The vets that we have are the vets that actually have agreements with us that they would not only take on one student, but they would take on in the future several students and train them as vet assistants. So if you want to learn more about that, you can email me. I will put my email in the chat box. But the last, oh, and so don't bother with this. This is messy. But once again, I can talk more about this if you are interested. But the last thing that I want to talk about, oh, there's my email there, is I've been contacted recently by the Mayor's Office of Animal Welfare. And there is a distinct interest by different agencies that are based around New York City to employ students coming out of our program, especially in order to diversify the groups, the agencies and stuff like that. And especially to address that, especially with COVID-19, that the need for animal care has risen. I think a lot of you may know that because of COVID-19, many animal shelters were actually basically their animals were being adopted, right? So that there is an increased need for people who are basically interested in animal care, animal management, animal welfare. So I thank you all for your attention, and I welcome any questions at the end from you. Thanks a lot.
Thank you so much, Professor Araya. I'm going to share this again to make sure we're on track. If you have any questions about animal care, and there was a specific question from Evelyn, I believe.
Hi, Evelyn.
Evelyn, if you want to ask that question now, you can as we make the transition.
Please do. Hi, Evelyn. Evelyn?
I think she said she put it in the chat and she basically asked,
where's Evelyn?
She wanted to know about some of the classes, so we'll try to loop in with her again later on.
Yeah, sure.
Or you can check in the chat. Her name is Evelyn.
Okay, gotcha. Thank you.
All right. So thank you so much for that dynamic presentation. We're now going to continue with the show, and we're going to move on to biology, which is the liberal arts option, and that the course coordinator for that is Dr. Charles Melidi. You're on mute, Dr. Melidi.
There we go. Okay.
There we go.
All right, great. Thank you so much. So I'm glad you're here this afternoon. My name is Charles Melidi, coordinator for biological sciences program, biology major program. And what I'm going to share with you here is a broad overview of the bio majors program here at BCC. And we prepared this work, these slides, together with input or contribution from Lee Abbas, Rafi Diodi, and Rasheen Allen. First item. What is really biology? Well, in general, biology is the study of living organisms and how these living organisms interact with the environment and how this is relevant. Now, there are many diverse career fields that require a foundation in biology, and this includes the following: medicine, ecology, microbiology, molecular biology, bioinformatics, biochemistry, et cetera. And therefore, we wanted to share with you the program that can enable you to major in biology, as well as be able to graduate in 4 semesters. We want you to graduate in 4 semesters. Now, also, it's very important to mention that biology overlaps with various other disciplines, including chemistry and computer science, et cetera. Next item. How does the market, the job market look like currently for bio majors? Now, as you can see right here, this is a projected growth in 2029, 5% for bio technicians. Bioengineer 5% increase, and the median salaries on the right hand side, we have 45,000 for biotechnicians, average per year, bioengineers about 91,000, genetic counselors 81,000, physician assistant, physician as well as surgeons about 200,000 plus, physical therapist 89, physician assistant 112,000, medical assistant 34,000 average, vets 95,000 average, medical scientists 88,000, and environmental scientist specialists about 71,000. Now, notice the projected growth in this field is ranges from 5% to 21%. Therefore, you are actually, if you're interested in biology, you are developing this interest at the right time. The future is very bright for those of you who like to major in biology. And these are some of the options that are available to you as of now, and will continue to be available to you for the next 10 years plus. Okay. Career options. On career options, some of our students who graduate from BCC as bio majors are branch of and currently are working as physician assistant. There's a long list starting from some of our students working at Bronx, Lebanon. I'm not sure if I can give you the names, but one of our students, her name is Carla. She works at the Bronx, Lebanon as a physician assistant, and there are other students. Most of the students want to graduate from BCC and they like to to pursue the care of physician peer program, physician assistant. I've transferred to your college as well as City College program for a peer program. Some of our other students have also branched off to Mercy College. And one of the students actually sent an email this summer, last year in June, that she graduated from Mercy College. And she was at BCC for about 2 semesters, that she transferred to Mercy College. Others work as medical assistant, vets, genetic counselors, medical school, or medical doctors. One of our students works now as a medical doctor at Mount Sinai. He graduated from BCC as a biomed in 2008, then completed his bachelor's at Cornell, then medical school at Mount Sinai. But the real key point is that, yes, we have a long list of students now working as medical doctors, as physician assistant, as a pharmacist, researchers, and these are just some of the options that are available to you. So the key point is that you are not limited by your capability. Each one of you is hardworking, brilliant, but you're limited by, we're only limited by our imagination. Therefore, I want you to think about possibilities that are available to you as a bio major. There are many options that are available to you. Next slide. How do we do this? Diane. Okay. Here we go. Oh, thank you so much. Did I do something else? Okay. 1 second, please. Apologies for that. Okay. I'm sharing the wrong screen right now. Okay, there we go. Oh, thank you. All right, so how do we get you to, how does the biology curriculum look like? Now, we have what are known as core requirements right here. Core requirements include the English composition, English 111 and 10, 101, 111. Then we need the math 30, then life science needs chemistry. Then there are several courses that you need to select from here. World cultures, 3 credits, et cetera. Scientific or in the chem 12, which is general chemistry 2, and then of course we have electives. And to get you to graduate in 4 semesters, not 2.5 years, not 3 years, maximum 4 semesters. And if you include the summers, we can get to graduate in about, yes, about 2 years. These are the options. 2-year program, we want you to go in for 2-year program. So for first semester, we'd like you to begin your series for chemistry, chem 11. And then also you start your series for math 30. And then this next semester, okay, here we go. You take chem 12 and then math 31. And next semester, and then in addition, of course, to other regular class, for example, English composition and one of the flexible core program courses. Third semester, you need to take math chem 32 and bio 11. And folks, and a flexible core. Now we have bio 11 right here. And your last semester, fourth semester, you take chem 22 and bio 12. And of course, in between, you'll be taking the other courses. Why do you need to start the chemistry series earlier and the math series earlier? This is primarily because the chemistry and the math courses run in series. We have a series of 4 courses in chemistry, general chemistry 1 and 2, and then organic chemistry 1 and 2. The same applies to math. We have math 30, 31, and 32. And biology, we have bio 11 and bio 12. So you need to take these courses in series, and you need to start these courses earlier so they can be able to graduate on time. All right, so I just want to share this information with you regarding bio majors, the possibilities, the future that is very bright for each one of you. And also to encourage you to, encourage you to take these courses and to stay, to be optimistic, and also to be to contact your advisors, whether it's your biology advisor, your technology advisor, because once you contact your advisor, academic advisor, you're able to make progress much more efficiently. All right, so these are the options available to you. I thank each one of you, and we have some additional information right here. These are the faculty advisors for various programs, beginning with animal care management, Professor Raya, who's here, Diane Price for medical lab tech, biotech, Rafi Diodi, horticulture, Adibola, and biology, you can always, and the contacts are ready on the screen. Thank you so much. If you have any questions, I'll happily answer your questions.
Thank you so much, Dr. Melidi. For the interest of time, we will jump right into our last presentation. If you have any questions for Dr. Melidi, you did a fantastic job, and that was great PowerPoint that you put up there. I would recommend that you write it in the chat. We will have, again, at the end of this last presenter's presentation, we will have the opportunity to engage with all the speakers today, including Any of the internship specialist is on, Paula Wicklin. So if you have any questions about the internships, you can ask us or her. We also have some advisors on that can help answer some of your questions. And we also have an admissions person on the call to also answer the questions if you want to come into BCC and enroll in any of these programs. So without further ado, let us move down to horticulture. The course coordinator, as Dr. Melidi said, is Dr. Adejat Adebola. So I'm going to allow her to share her screen and she can begin her presentation. Welcome, Dr. Adebola. You are on mute. Just so you know, you're still on mute. Okay.
So sorry, I have three different screens, and so I windows are everywhere. So I apologize. Okay, so let me just share my screen. And can everyone see my screen?
Yes.
Yes, okay. So good afternoon, guys, on this very lovely sunny Friday, one of the few sunny Fridays of this year. I'm very happy about that. I'm actually very excited when it's sunny. I hope everyone's doing well. So as Dr. Price Banks mentioned, I'm Adejat Adebola. I am the program coordinator in the Department of Biological Sciences. And I'm gonna talk to you about horticulture. So just wanna sort of give you a short intro for those of you who are not familiar with this field in biology. So what is horticulture, right? So horticulture is this really diverse study, a diverse area of study. So one can define it as essentially the art and science of producing and improving and commercializing edible plants, vegetables, flowers, herbs, ornamental plants. These are all plants that are grown for decorative purposes in our gardens, as part of landscape design projects, as house plants, et cetera. So the study and pursuit of horticulture as a career is important because plants are vital to our existence, right? Plants basically matter. They matter a lot. And so pursuing horticulture can be a rewarding experience. The sustainable production and consumption of, the sustainable consumption of high quality fruits and vegetables contributes to our overall physical health. If you think about the turf that we play on, the use of flowers and ornamental plants to create very calm green spaces that enrich our communities, these are all factors that contribute to our sense of well-being. And so for these reasons, horticulture is a very, very important, horticulture is a very, very important field in biology. And I don't know about you, but when, you know, flowers start to bloom and the sun is out, I feel happier. So that aspect of it contributing to our overall mental well-being as well as our physical well-being, I think is one of the things that will draw many of you to horticulture. So there are fields of horticulture that are concerned with using plants to combat harmful effects of climate change. So using plants to improve air quality, water quality, our water availability, using plants as a clean renewable energy source so that we can reduce our reliance on harmful fossil fuels. So that there's aspects of horticulture that deal with that. There are horticulturists that have an interest in preserving native habitats like nature preserve that you see here at the National Park in Alberta, Canada. They recognize that every living thing on the planet is intimately connected. And so maintaining that ecosystem is important for us. And when you hear the term sustainability, you know, plants play a major role in that too. You know, for example, our population is predicted to reach 8.5 billion in less than 10 years. So how do we feed 8.5 billion people, right? How do we ensure that we have arable land and clean water and energy resources to support 8.5 billion people? Well, horticulturalists come into play. And so horticulturists are trained to meet these demands. And so it's another reason why the field of horticulture is an important field to consider. So as I mentioned, horticulture is a really, really diverse area. There are many different careers that fall under horticulture. So you can think of horticulture as this huge umbrella. And under this huge umbrella, there are many, 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 many different subfields. So if you're interested in growing food, for example, there's urban farming, there's a greenhouse growing, there are people that are hydroponic specialists. So instead of using soil to grow plants, they use water and supply nutrients to grow plants. If you're actually interested in the basic sciences related to horticulture, there are entomologists that study insects. There are botanists that specialize in plant biology. You know, maybe you're interested in preserving native habitats, or you're interested in more climate sciences. There are people that are going to be involved in habitat restoration. If you're interested in landscape design, they're arborists, they're groundskeepers, they're gardeners, they're landscape designers. So there are many, many, many different subfields within horticulture that you can pursue. So the table here shows various careers within the umbrella of horticulture and the median salary for these individual career choices. Of course, the salaries would be higher or lower depending on where you are in the country and depending on your experience. Horticulture, unlike the other programs here, you can get far not so much with getting advanced degrees, unless you're going into basic sciences. You can get very far with experience, right? So volunteering at different gardens or parks or landscape facilities, who you know within the field is very, very important. So experience counts for a lot in this degree. I just wanted to point out that New York City recognizes the need for, recognize the need for growing food equity. So Councilman Corey Johnson, he put together a policy agenda to advance food equality and equity in New York City. And one of the recommendations for this policy agenda is to establish an urban agriculture in New York City. So there will be demand for horticulturalists, especially those that are interested in urban agriculture in the New York City area. All right, so BCC can help you on your horticulture career pathway. This is a 2-year associate in applied science degree program. This was originally structured as a terminal degree program with the idea that students would go through the program in 2 years, hopefully 2 years, and at the end of 2 years, they would be ready to enter into the job market. This program is in conjunction with the New York Botanical Gardens. So essentially our students are going to be taking classes on 2 campuses. You complete your liberal art courses at BCC and you complete your horticulture courses currently at the New York Botanical Gardens. And at the end of the program, we hope that students are prepared for employment in the horticulture industry, prepared to assume positions like assistant greenhouse manager or gardener at a public or private garden or state, that students should be able to safely and efficiently use garden, greenhouse, and landscape tools and equipment, that they understand the basic principles of plant growth and soil science, and that they're able to apply these principles in practice. And we also expect that students at the end of this program will be familiar with plant science terminology and sustainable horticulture practices and techniques. One thing that I want to emphasize is that if you are not an outdoors person, if you do not like to get your hands dirty, if you don't like to touch soil, if you are afraid of coming into contact with insects, if you have a problem with working when it's windy or when it's a little chilly or when it's raining, this is not the career path for you. If you are not interested in manual labor, this is not the career path for you. But if you love the outdoors, if you love to get your hands dirty, if you know, sinking your hand in soil is your jazz, right? Is a thing that gets you going. If you don't mind working in the, in, you know, in the rain or in the snow or when it's cold, then this is definitely or could definitely be a career choice for you. So as I mentioned, this is a joint program between BCC and NYBG. There are 32 credits that are taken at BCC and the remaining 28 credits are taken at NYBG. So the BCC credits are similar to the credits that you've seen with MLT, animal care, liberal arts biology, and biotechnology. So of course, there's an English course, English 11, rhetoric and composition. There's an introduction to modern world history course. There's a fundamentals of interpersonal communications course. You have a choice between taking either sociology, introduction to sociology, or an introduction to psychology course. You have a choice of taking the numerous phys ed courses that are offered by BCC. You also have the choice of taking a one credit music course, intro to music course, or an intro to art course. In addition, students are required to take two business courses. There's a business mathematics course that's required, and then there's a business organization and management course. And the reason for these courses is that the program was originally designed, as I said, as a workforce development program. And so the idea was that the training that students received at BCC and NYBG would equip students to move seamlessly into the job market. And in fact, if they so chose, to actually start their business. So to encourage entrepreneurship in the field of horticulture. In addition, this is very important, students are required to take 1 year of biology, so bio 11 and bio 12, and one semester of chemistry, chem 17. And it is my recommendation that you complete these courses in your first year. In fact, you won't be able to start courses at NYBG until you complete the bio sequence and the chemistry sequence. So there are a number of courses that are given at NYBG, a total of 28 credits. And typically those 28 credits are completed within 2 to 3 semesters. In a given semester, you will probably take 10 or 11 horticulture courses. Now, I know that sounds overwhelming, but all of these horticulture courses are one credit and the courses are overlapping. Unlike the courses at BCC, the NYBG courses are not 15 weeks long. So you could have a course, let's say basic botany, for example, and that basic botany course will last for the first 6 weeks or 7 weeks of the semester. So by mid-semester, you're done with that course, right? And then maybe you'll take a soil science course, and maybe the soil science course won't start until mid-semester. Basic botany may start in August and end in October, while soil science begins in October and ends in December. So even though you're taking 10 to 11 courses within a given semester, the courses are overlapping, so you're not taking them at the same time. All of the courses at NYBG, with the exception of the fieldwork experience courses, which have the course code HRT and a preparation for pesticide application certification course, though all of those courses are one credit, with the exception of those courses that I just mentioned. Because these courses are one credit, it is unlikely that the horticulture courses will transfer to another 4-year institution. So keep that in mind if you're thinking about transferring to a 4-year college. Your liberal arts courses like bio 11 and bio 12 and chem 17 are likely to be transferable, but the botany, the horticulture courses are unlikely to be transferred. So there are a number of different types of horticulture courses that you take at NYBG. They cover many aspects of botany, aspects of soil science. Many of the courses are hands-on courses. So you're learning greenhouse practices, you're learning practices of landscape gardening, you're learning about pesticide application, you're learning about pruning, landscape design, how to format a landscape plan, if that's what you're interested in. And then we have our fieldwork experience courses. So like animal care and like MLT, students are required to complete a number of experiential learning hours for graduation. So for horticulture, students are required to complete 540 hours of fieldwork experience. And the 540 hours is divided into subsections of horticulture. So we have a turfs and grounds management fieldwork experience, arboriculture, perennial and flower borders, greenhouse operations, and then we have an elective. So the elective is 60 hours. The other four fieldwork experience courses are 120 hours each. Students will typically complete these hours at various internship sites that with partners that we have. So we are currently partnered with the New York Botanical Gardens. We've sent students to complete greenhouse rotations at Lehman College. Lehman College has three greenhouses, two rooftop greenhouses. And we have a relationship with Brooklyn Bridge Park. We've sent students to Randall's Island Park. We have a new partnership with Governor's Island. They are hosting our students for the arboriculture rotation. So learning about tree management, tree care, how to climb trees, how to prune trees for the different seasons. We have a relationship with Concrete Safari. One of the benefits for our students working with them is that they are a community organization. They develop community gardens on New York housing property. And so you get to learn about urban agriculture as well as community outreach. We are developing partnerships with Brooklyn Grange Farms. We are developing partnerships with the Green Bronx Machine as well as Harlem Grown and Teams for Food Justice. So if you have an interest in urban agriculture, there are sites available where you can get that experience. And so I do have a degree map for students, and I see that I have 2 minutes left. So I won't go into detail. If you want to know about how you should progress through the classes, please contact me via email, or you can go into Starfish and make an appointment for a Zoom meeting with me. My office hours are Mondays and Wednesdays, 3 to 4 p.m. this semester. So one of the great things about our partnership with NYBG is that our students have access to the resources that are available at NYBG. So our students can participate in the lectures and symposia that are hosted by NYBG. I encourage students to attend. I also encourage students to sign up for the Metro Hort Group. The Metro Hort Group is an organization of many, many different horticulture specialists throughout the tri-state area. They have a wonderful jobs board that lists the various job openings available throughout the tri-state area. They also host a yearly symposium called Plantorama, which is very exciting. You get to learn about the newest trends in horticulture, the various policies that are happening in different states across the nation with regards to horticulture as well. And so lastly, I just wanted to leave you with this quote: plants are our food, oxygen, medicine. Some even say they are one of the most pleasurable experiences on earth. From the flowers to the trees and the seas filled with coral dreams, the earth's natural flora has inspired and enhanced humans for as long as time can tell. That's why the power of plants is the key to unlocking our key of enjoyment, unlocking our enjoyment of life. Thank you so much for listening to me. Again, my contact information is below, and I'll also put my contact information in the chat. If there are any questions, I'm more than happy to answer. And thank you for taking time out to listen to all of us today.
Thank you so much, Dr. Adibola. That was fantastic as usual. There are some questions in the chat. That was a comment. They said that was a wonderful presentation. So we're going to open up the floor now to our panel discussion, and then we're going to close. So I'm going to highlight the speakers and allow the audience to ask their questions. And just so everyone understands, you can unmute at this point and ask any of the speakers your questions. I am for MLT. You have Dr. Adibola, who is for horticulture. You have Dr. DOT for biotechnology. You have Professor Raya, who's doing animal care. You have Dr. Melidi, who's doing biology. I also wanna take this moment to introduce the advisors. I'm gonna spotlight Maricela Acevedo. She's been active in the chat for everybody. She is our ASAP advisor. So can you give them a little brief description on what ASAP is really quickly?
Sure, can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay. Good afternoon, everyone. So I'm an ASAP advisor, and we are pretty much an accelerated associates program, meaning we really concentrate on the student completing their degree within 5 semesters. Nursing degrees can go to 6 semesters, and if so, ASAP works with the student to stay within that range. Also, we have a lot of that relationship with the student where we want the student to check in with us twice a month. We have a lot of career workshops that we do as well, like resume writing, career exploration, scholarship information. We also have different entities that come in to do their presentations as well outside of BCC. And I've been with ASAP going on 4 years. I've been at BCC since 2016. And I'm the MLT liaison. So I get emails from students or things that are passed down from Dr. Banks. So if anyone has a question regarding that, I'm going to put my information in the chat and you can reach out to me, and I'm happy to be here.
Thank you so much for that, Maricela. So just want to make sure everybody knows who's in the building. We did get some questions from some people previously. So if you don't want to open up your mic or type your chat, your question in the chat, I'm going to say the question that you guys submitted upon your registration. One student said, I currently hold a bachelor's of science degree in biology from Lehman. What credits would be accepted? So for MLT, the credits that will be accepted are anything related to the MLT program. So we'll accept your chemistries, 11, 12, or 17 and 18. We will accept your biologies, general biology 1 and 2, anatomy and physiology 1 and 2, your English, math, college algebra with trigonometry. We'll also accept pre-calculus, okay? Any of the liberal arts courses like the psychology, sociologies, the maths, the arts, et cetera. Typically, we do not accept transfer credits for MLT classes, only because these are specialized classes. Now, if a person did go to York College, for example, or they went to Hunter College and it was part of their MLS program, then we will accept those MLT credits transferred in. That's the exception. But other than that, we will accept the liberal arts courses. Any of the panelists want to talk about a bachelor's member coming into, yes, or?
So for horticulture, actually we get a number of students that are second degree students. So your liberal arts courses will likely be transferable, although I will say that I think there is a limit to how long ago you've taken the courses. So for example, if you took a biology course 10 years ago, you know, biology has, you know, there are some changes in biology from 10 years ago to now. And so I'm not entirely sure if the college will accept those credits. I believe there is a time limit to how long ago you have taken those courses. So you can confirm with your advisors on that. We do have some students who have taken courses at the New York Botanical Garden. So the New York Botanical Garden has their own School of Professional Horticulture. So we have some students who come in with credits from NYBG, and those credits will be are transferable. We will accept those credits as courses taken. Be advised though that there is a limit to the number of transfer credits that are that is accepted by BCC, and I believe the limit is 30, if I'm not mistaken.
Thank you so much. I think Dr. Malidi had his hand up.
Yes, for biology, quite frequently we do get students who would like to come back to BCC to take courses in biology, even though they already have a bachelor's in a different field. And most of the students come back, for example, because they like to branch off into pharmacy program or peer program or physical therapy program. And therefore, because they have, for example, a bachelor's, let's say, for example, in history, they'll just come back to BCC and they'll take the sequence of courses. So we'd accept math, English, and then the student enroll in bio 11, bio 12, and they take chem 11, general chemistry 1, general chemistry 2, and then organic chemistry. And up within two semesters, they'll be able to graduate as a BCC bio majors. Then from there they can, because they already have a bachelor's, they can apply to the peer program, pharmacy program, et cetera. So they already have the prerequisites to qualify for the specialized programs. Thanks.
Thank you so much.
Sorry, I would say that in general, when you're transferring in or you've completed a degree, if you are in CUNY, probably there are a lot of the basic courses, the general courses that can transfer. But most likely, and this is in general, not just for biotech or so on, you should assume that the courses that are specific for the program, even if you have taken them, they will not transfer. You have to do the BCC. But again, there's a limit of time and there's a limit of numbers of credits. The best thing that you can do is talk to your advisor and see what's transferable. But for example, if you're getting into our courses, which are into our programs that are biology, you may be able to bring in the English, a lot of the other general courses that you have had to take at your college anyway, maybe some of the basic one, depending on what you've taken and if it's comparable to the lab classes that we require. So if you've taken a biology that was for non-scientists at the time, it's probably not going to transfer like a full course.
Thank you so much. I want to take this moment to introduce Anisha Scott from the Missions Department. She's been very active in the chat. I just wanted to introduce her to the students. Anisha, do you want to unmute yourself and basically explain what you've been talking about in the chat in regards to the transfer credits?
Hello?
Yes, we can hear you.
Okay. Hello, everyone. My name is Anisha Scott. I'm an admissions counselor at Bronx Community College. As part of the transfer credits, you really won't know how many credits will transfer over until you've been officially accepted to the college. And then your transfer credits are evaluated, and you'll know exactly how many classes will then transfer over when you speak with an academic advisor. As the other representatives have been mentioning to you, yes, English classes will transfer over, math classes will transfer over, those classes don't expire. But if you have taken any chemistry classes or any bio classes, well, I would say over 5 years old, then those classes, they will transfer over, but unfortunately, you will have to retake those classes over. Because as we all know, science has definitely changed. So you will, most likely, you may have to retake those classes over if you have taken them, and if they are over, I believe it's either 5 or 7 years old. So it's possible that if you have taken any bio or chemistry classes over 7 or 5 years old, that you will have to take them over. And as far as CUNY students, if you have gotten your bachelor's from a CUNY school, it's possible that you can have more than 30 credits transfer over. I can't say you'll have 50 or 40 credits transfer. It's not really that many credits with transfer because we are a community college. We only offer associate's degree, so we can't say that, you know, that 40 credits will transfer over and then that you'll only need the remaining credits for you to get your associate. It doesn't work like that. Generally, we only accept a maximum of 30 credits to be transferred over. And I believe someone on.
Anisha, can you check your mic? We can't hear you very well at this point.
Okay, give me 1 second. Let me see if I can fix that.
Thanks.
Mic. Can you guys hear me now?
Yeah,
not very well.
But, okay,
it's low.
Better now, or it's still too low?
Wasn't that a commercial? Can you hear me now?
No, it's low.
It's low?
Yes.
I'm not sure why it's low. Oh, let me see. Give me 1 second. I'm sorry.
Just be a New Yorker and scream into it.
Hello?
Yes, we can hear you. It's just low. So you can close out because we're running out of time.
How about now?
Oh, perfect.
Okay. Much better, right?
Yes.
Okay. Yes. As I mentioned, we only can accept a maximum of 30 credits. But if you have been to a CUNY school, it's possible that we can accept a little more than 30 credits. We can't say that we can accept 40 credits. But as the other representatives have mentioned, that it is possible that if you have taken any bio or chemistry classes over 5 or 7 years old, is most likely you will have to retake those classes over. But English classes, math classes, psych classes, those classes don't expire. You definitely will be able to then transfer those classes over. But you really won't know exactly how many classes will transfer over until you've been applied, accepted, and then you speak directly with an academic advisor. They'll let you know which classes transfer over versus which classes didn't transfer over.
Thank you so much for
that. You're very welcome.
Just want to give you guys a bit of codified information. MLT is one of the only programs at BCC that can accept up to 33 credits because our program is 66 credits. So traditionally everyone else can do 30 credits. MLT, because we're 66 credits, can take in 33 credits. So that's the only exception to the rule. I want to move on to Evelyn Sosa Gonzalez. She has a question. Ms. Gonzalez.
Yeah, good afternoon. I want to thank everybody for taking time out of their day to go over with us. The only question I had was, I took a college class now during my high school senior year for English for hostels. Would it transfer the credit?
What English?
What English? English 110. Hostels college.
It'll transfer over.
All right. Thank you.
No problem.
Okay, thank you for that. We have another question that came to us. They want to know, what are the fundamentals of horticulture? What are the fundamentals of horticulture?
Oh, so the program is geared towards teaching students about plant biology. So we're talking about plant form and structure, plant physiology, plant diversity. You'll get courses on soil science. So the makeup of soil, the importance of various minerals and nutrients that are available in soil that help to support the health of plants. You'll get some instruction on pesticide use, sustainable practices, and then you'll get hands-on coursework. Dealing with greenhouse practices, proper use of fertilizers, how to properly prune, how to lay out a particular landscape for garden beds, et cetera. Did I answer your question?
I guess that was the question. Thank you. All right, we have one more question, but it is 2:00. The last question was, They needed a refresher on an MLT advisement. So basically, really quickly, 30-second answer, if you are a BCC student already, you can go to the BCC MLT website. We have two advisors. We have Diana Martell, who does the non-ASAP advising or assists with the non-ASAP advising. And then we have Maricela Acevedo, who was active in the chat, who's the MLT advisor, liaison. Thank you. Those two are the critical people that's going to help guide you and navigate you to the right areas to get to me, which is the interview. Beside that, if you're not part of the BCC body of students yet, then you want to reach out to the admissions department, and that's Anisha Scott. Those are the individuals you want to speak with in order to get into the BCC program. You cannot do advisement until you are an active student in the BCC campus. So if you become a BCC student, reach out to me, reach out to Maricela, reach out to Diana. We do have some work in progress that needs to be done with the advisement of once a student comes in. So feel free to work out, reach out to any one of us so we can make sure that you are on track to where you need to be. Okay, so I wanna thank everybody.
I want to echo that too for horticulture, because horticulture is a really complex program. It's unlike the other programs at BCC because we're dealing with two different institutions. So it's imperative that if you're interested in horticulture to reach out to me or to reach out to Diana Martell.
Thank you so much for that. And that goes for every program. Reach out to the course coordinators, reach out to Diana Martell. If you're MLT, reach out to also ASAP. Yes, Maricela, want to say one more thing, although we're over. go.
Just one thing for all the students. I don't mind answering questions, of course. However, if you have something like, what's the ASAP program about, blah, blah, blah. I put the link for the ASAP program in the chat. If you still don't understand stuff about ASAP, I will break it down. We don't cover all the majors that are offered in BCC, so that's really important for students to know. And that was.
Thank you so much. All right, so today you learned about horticulture, medical laboratory technology program, biotechnology, animal care management, and biology as a liberal arts major. This was great and phenomenal opportunity to speak with you. I say this for all of these speakers. Thank you for coming. Please share this knowledge with everyone else. This was recorded, so we will put it on some type of public platform so that you can review the information. You have our individual information as well. If you don't, you can email me. My information is on the flyer, and I can put you in contact with any of the program coordinators that were seen today. Thank you so much. Be blessed and be safe.
Bye, everybody. Have a nice afternoon, nice weekend.
Peace out.
Thank you.
Safe.
Thank you.